What's up, ballers? I'm Rocky Cagnoni. I play professional paintball for Team Avalanche, and I'm going to be your host for Avalanche 101, man. I get a lot of questions asked by, like, newer players that come up to me, and they ask me, man, how do I become a better player? How do I make the pro level? How do I make my team better? Hopefully within the next hour or so, with a bunch of help from my team, we're going to answer some of those questions. And we also got some kids and parents, and they're going to ask some of us some questions also. But first, let me introduce you to the team.
You wanna fight?
Joe, those are my boys on Avalanche. They're some of the best players in the world. We've been playing the circuit for about 5 years together, like a huge family. What we're gonna do is answer some questions from the parents and kids, so check this out.
All right, now that I introduced the guys on Team Avalanche, gave you a little sneak peek on what a real pro game looks like. Scuba Steve in the house.
What's up?
LB. Take it away, guys.
What's up, kids? You're ready to start playing paintball. You want to get serious about it. What you're going to need is you're going to need mom and dad's support. And that means getting back and forth to the tournaments, getting extra money to get paintballs and whatnot. And you need mom and dad's support. Without mom and dad, you can't do anything.
In order to gain support, you're going to really need your parents to understand and comprehend what it's all about. With their support, it's going to make life a lot easier so you can get on that pro team and you can get to fields and tournaments and practices and, you know, like Brad said, extra money in your pockets, so you can buy paintballs. We're here with a couple dads from the contest winners, Rich and Mike, and we're gonna try and answer some questions and misunderstandings that they might have, and hopefully answer some questions for those parents at home.
Yeah, my young son, just getting into paintball, has worked hard at convincing me that it's a relatively safe sport, telling me it's safer than other sports. Can you make a comment on that?
Yeah, paintball compared to basketball, football, hockey, tennis, has lower injuries than any of those sports. And, you know, when played properly at a local field, when the safety rules are followed, chances of injury are slim to none. But it's no worse than, you know, playing football, putting a helmet on, and smashing into each other.
I have a son that plays, and he skateboards a lot right now, and he comes home with strawberries on his elbows, and
they just rub it right off and just keep going.
What kind of physical attributes does it take to play paintball?
Well, that's probably the greatest thing about paintball, is that you don't have to be 6'10", 235, ripped. You can be 5'5", like Rocky. You can be 6'2", 3", like me, 6 foot, like Rab. You can be in shape, out of shape, big, small, young, old.
Cool, now that we got the basics out of the way, we're gonna go over some of the equipment that you're gonna need to get you started. I got my buddy Travis over here with me, who works for JTUSA and plays for the team, and he's gonna help me out with some of the equipment.
Hey, what's up? To start off, you want to get into buying your equipment from a pro shop. Those guys have a lot of helpful advice. They know, they've been around the block, they know what's good for you, they know the good starter guns. Don't get looped into some generic plastic gun that's going to break after the first time you use it. They'll get you started in a good starter gun and give you helps on tanks and goggles and things like barrels. I know that's one of the things you want to talk about today, was barrels.
Yeah, definitely. There's three things that you want to look for in a barrel. A, you want to make sure you get a quality barrel from a quality manufacturer. You just don't want to get a piece of tubing with holes drilled in it. First thing you want to look for is bore size. Now, you're not going to just get one barrel. That's going to be impossible. You're going to need at least three bore sizes to match your paint. Paintballs are 68 caliber. You probably want to get a barrel that's for a small bore, which is small paint, probably around 6.85, 6.86. Then you want to step up to maybe a 6.88 for medium bore size paint. And then maybe jump to 690, 691 for large bore paint, because climate and weather affect the actual size of your paintball. So you want to get about three different bore sizes so you can match it up to accommodate all your paint. Second thing is porting. Porting is important because what it does is it releases excess gas in front of your ball and behind your ball, and just gives it a truer flight. And the next thing would probably be after that would be actual length of the barrel. Me being a front player, I like barrels anywhere from 12 to 14 inch. What do you say, Travis, for being a back player? What size do you guys normally use?
Back guys typically use a longer barrel, 16 inch barrel. Me and the other back guys on the circuit find that you can use the barrel to actually get in the grooves on the hyperball tubes and the stand-up tubes. You can actually put it right in the ridge and wrap with that, so you're not giving that much of a target. You're just basically, it's your little gun turret. I even know a few front guys that actually prefer longer barrels to like shove through little holes in the bunkers and that kind of thing too. But for the most part, I don't think you want to have a massive barrel in the front if you're going to start leading with your barrel at a good shot. So,
next thing we want to look into is packs. Now, packs, pretty much basic design. What you want to look for when you're getting a pack is A, you want some back support with your pack. You want Velcro closures, like this one has here. And you want good sized webbing right here. You don't want a skinny belt that's gonna just cut into your stomach all day, especially if you're playing all day tournaments or something like that. You want something that's halfway decent size so it feels comfortable, you're wearing it all day. You want thick webbing with Velcro closures to tighten the tension of the actual pack. Keep everything nice and tight, that way if you're a front guy and you're running real fast, you're passing out
jiggling around or you know, breaking paint. You want to just get Velcro closures. It doesn't matter if you get full tube closures or half tube closures like this one, whichever you like. It's pretty much, when it comes down to pack, it's pretty much personal preference of what you choose. Front players like myself, between a 3 and 5 pack, you shouldn't really need more than that. I don't carry more than 5 pots, even when I think I'm mowing my gun. 5 pots is the max I carry. Fat guys like Travis here carry, what, 9, 11 pots?
Yeah. We usually carry 9 packs, 11 packs. Some of the guys get into like 13 or 14s, but those guys are psychos. That's pretty much a case of paint on your back. Basically, what we're doing with that much paint out there is you're playing a tournament, you have teammates out there that need your support. We're constantly shooting lanes and holding in the other team to kind of get a domination thing going to let these guys just run around and get in position. And then when we're reloading, they're already in spot. It's just it's a dominance thing. So. In a 10-15 minute game, we'll shoot basically a case of paint from the backfield.
Cool. Packs out of here. Next thing we got coming up is pads. Now most people think pads, people that wear pads and paintball, are to protect themselves from the paintballs. Not true. Pads, you got leg pads and elbow forearm pads. Now these pads are used for sliding, more to protect your body than from paintballs. Abrasion resistant, they usually have little plastic cups to protect your elbows. And then like I said, they're mostly there to protect yourself from sliding, from crawling on your elbows or on your knees, and just to help yourself from not getting beat up too bad. Bad guys don't wear them much because they're standing all the time. They got it easy.
Wear little knee pads just so. In case we ever have to get on our knees, they're there. This is a set of the new JT goggles. Basically, when you're looking for goggles, there's a couple of things you want to look for. I can't stress enough how important it is to get into a higher end goggle. It's something that you're gonna be wearing this thing all day. It's gonna be hot, sweaty, this and that. You want something that has a nice foam, a nice feel to it, something that just kind of sits on your head and you're not bothered by it. Another thing that's gonna ruin your day is if your lenses are fogging. This is a dual pane thermal lens. Basically, what that does is creates this layer inside the lens to where you don't fog. You can really run around outside there, and you're not going to fog.
And another thing that's important with the goggles is peripheral vision. You want to make sure you have a good area of range that you're looking through. And usually, your best bet is to go big on your first goggle expense, get it out of the way. Most people, they look at goggles and say, oh, you know, $70, that's crazy. Actually, goggles are probably your best investment. A, it's a big safety thing, you want to protect your eyes, you only have 2 of them. And B, you're going to be wearing around all day, and that's what makes most people uncomfortable is actual wearing a goggle, because it's hot, you're breathing, your breath's coming back. Get a quality goggle and you'll have no problems and you'll be a lot happier in the long run. Just go big right off the bat and get yourself a good set of goggles. All right, this is my favorite part, talking about markers. Million different kinds of markers you can get. Depends what you're doing. Tournament ball, I'd say you want to go Electra. I mean, that's the way everything's going. Electronic is the way to go. Two reasons. A, the rate of fire is unbelievable on any Electro that you get. And B, you can pretty much battle out of any position with electronic. If you have a pneumatic gun, if you're a right-hander, you shoot the pneumatic gun a little bit slower with your left hand. Not true with electronics. Pretty much if you shoot right-handed, you can pretty much shoot your gun just as fast left-handed with an electronic gun because the ease of shooting. I mean, electronics, you have no trigger pull. All it is pretty much like a mouse click on a computer. And if you want to compete in today's tournament play, you definitely need like an electronic pneumatic gun. That way you can lay the paint on.
Another thing you guys want to talk about is your air system. When you first start off, you're going to get into probably CO2. One of the most common sizes is probably 20 ounce.
Yeah, 20 ounce.
Yeah, 20 ounces is a good size. And that's going to be in your starter guns, your mid-level guns. I mean, typically you don't want to get into that when you're talking about an electronic gun. That CO2 gets in there, forms liquid. That's water and electronics don't mix. Compressed air is the second step in air systems. That's something that You want to get into a 4,500 PSI, don't even mess around with 3,000. You get a lot more bang for your buck with a 4,500 system. Play an entire game, few games ever filling your tank. And this is an 88 system. Basically, that means it's an 88 cubic inch tank. So I have 4,500 PSI throughout 88 cubic inches. Rocky, on the other hand, what size bottle is that?
A little 45 cubic inch. For us front players, this is the pop bottle, I like to call it.
That's the baby bottle.
This is a cute baby bottle. This is all you need if you play front. And with your compressed air system, of course, you get a front regulator. And all that does is regulate 4,500 PSI that's in your bottle down to whatever marker that you decide on getting down to that PSI. Right now, this is 4,500 into 450 PSI, so it cuts down quite a bit. Markers and compressed air systems are pretty high tech. So before we end up leaving you guys, I just want to make sure, let you know, go to your pro shop, ask those guys. More than likely, they should have a couple people that actually play at the shop. And I mean, ask them what they use. See if you can go in the back and try out some of the guns that they have on the wall. Try to shoot a barrel. If they're a straight up pro shop, they should pretty much let you shoot that gun before you get it. And don't be afraid to ask questions. I mean, we all start at the same spot. Don't think that a question is going to make you look stupid. Just go out, ask all the questions you need to ask, and definitely go through a shop. And you should be good to go. That's now that we went over all the basic equipment stuff, grab your kit. Let's go out and get on the field.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Peace.
Later.
Adios.
Bye.
Now that you've got your gear, you need to know what to do with your gear. What you gotta realize is paintball is just a big strategy match. It's almost like a chess match with markers. So what you need to do is walk the field. We got our field captain, Scuba Steve, here. He's gonna help me out.
What's up, Rod?
What's up, Doc?
All right, let's start off with airball first. It's supposed to be the same all the way across from front to back, but it's usually not. So what you need to do is get on one side of the field, really walk it thoroughly, and then walk to the other side. And you'll slowly see that there's different angles and bunkers are off just by inches. And those inches are gonna make the big difference on you and your team succeeding and pushing through a side. So you really got to concentrate on angles. And you'll see that if you're like on one side of the field, you can stand on the bunker on the show tape and look across and say, this line here isn't like this on the other side. That's the difference in you succeeding, is walking the fields. That's where the tournaments are won. Naming your bunkers is an important thing. A lot of the airball fields that are out there now, they got what they call Dorito or Nacho, and then you got your wing nuts. You got to learn all your bunkers that are on the field and your positions. And that is where a tournament is won. That's where Avalanche really concentrates when we get to a tournament, is walking the field, because it is where I feel that we succeed a little bit further than other teams out there. All right, now that you've got the field figured out and you've walked the field thoroughly and you know all the key angles on the field, now you got to position your team. You got to position the players, your front players, your mid players, and your back players. You got to really figure out who's your best communicators and usually put them in the middle of the field so they can communicate right and left. You, the captain, need to figure that out, and you, the team, you need to help the captain figure that out and work with him.
All right, we've already discussed walking the fields before you play. Now we're going to go over the breakout, what to do actually when they call game on. We got Martinez, Scuba, Roberts, and LB, and they're going to give you the lowdown on what to do. Cool, Rab, why don't you show the kids a skinny on some breakout skills, man?
Word. First things first, you got back players, mid players, and front players, and everybody's got a special job that they got to do on the field. So what we're going to do next is start with our front players, E-Rob and Rock Dog.
As a front player, you need to be sprinting out to your spots, and these are going to be the spots that you chose when you're walking the fields earlier. But remember, the straightest line to your bunker isn't always the best line.
Yeah, what you want to do being a front player, you need pads, first of all. Second of all, you want to slide in there Pete Rose style, man. You don't want to slow down. You want to go full bore, slide in there, slide about 15 feet before you get to the actual bunker. If you come up short, not a big deal, man. Just crawl up in there and you're good to go.
Right on, Hot Shots. Well, let's go show the paintball world what we're talking about, and let's lead them the way.
Cool.
All right, I'll get my gear.
See how Eric took his running lane? Watch what happens when he just runs directly from point A to B. Now watch how the Rock Dog slides. Notice how far he is from the bunker.
Now that we've got the front players out of the way, I'm here with Cash Money Martinez. He's going to give us a down low on what mid players do and what they're not supposed to do. Hit it up.
Mid players are very important. Mid players come out shooting with their head up, pain in the air, making sure they put down the front players that are trying to move into those front spots. Eliminations in the break are very important, and back players and mid players are the key people to make that happen.
Now say you're on the breakout, you guys have come out and you guys are mowing. What happened if you guys are getting sweet spotted yourselves?
You're running hide, but it's important not to be scared. You gotta get in your bunker. Make sure you live. You can't do your damage if you're dead.
Cool, Cash Money. Why don't you show me how it's done then, man?
All right, then check this out. Right, chill. I'm coming out with my gun blazing to the last 10 or 15 feet, throwing paint at people. Then I need to get in my bunker. If I start to pull up and realize there's a lot of people shooting at me, I'm just gonna get in my bunker quickly.
Now, what are you doing in your bunker?
Mid players get to make most of the eliminations. You should be in a bunker with lots of shot options, possibly a chance for a sweet spot, and a chance to knock out a bunch of front players from the other team. That's basically what a mid guy needs to do off the break.
Excellent. Now that we got the front and mid players taken care of, what we're gonna do now is go to the back line or back players. And LB's gonna help us out today. He's one of the best back players there is. Tell us what's up, LB.
Basically, as a back guy, you're not gonna do a whole lot of sprinting, diving at the initial start of the game. You're gonna wanna kinda walk or do the Travis Trot to your bunker. And as soon as you get there, you wanna start throwing paint immediately. Your job is to throw enough paint out there so you allow your front guys to get in, your mid guys to develop a game. And your main responsibility is gonna come later in the latter part of the game. You're gonna be responsible for closing it, helping front guys out, giving them enough paint so they can go to work, and allowing your mid guys to break the game wide open.
Got you on the breakout, we got you into your bunkers. We're gonna show you how to play this spot. We're gonna start with the front players first. Got Eric Roberts, Scuba Steve with me. Scuba, so when you're doing your thing, what's going on?
Well, as a front player, my job for the team is to get up all the way to my first position, and if at all possible, to keep moving forward. Because as I'm moving forward, my mid players can start coming in and taking my positions, and then the other team then has a hard time locating exactly where I'm at, and then it opens the door for the team to keep doing what it's got to do.
Another big thing is communication. Communication is the biggest part of the game. You can talk to your back guys, relay what's going to be going on. You're able to set up plays, set up moves. That way you have the full cover and full fire support that you need when you're moving.
And what you got to realize when you're playing the front, you're the farthest guy up on the field, so you're the number one priority to the other team. I mean, you got to learn, once you get into your bunker, you got to stay there, stay down, chill out for a little bit. For the first 5 minutes, just hang out. Remember, if you have three guys up on you shooting at you, that frees up everything. So that means there's three guys on you, that leaves the mid players open to do whatever kind of damage they want. Cool. That takes us to what the mid players or insert players are looking for. Today we got two of the best. Chris Gloryboy Lasoya, by far one of the best players in the world. Cash Money Martinez. You blink 2 seconds and these guys are stabbing two or three of your guys right off the bat.
Yeah, this is what makes the game the best, being a game breaker. What you do is you get to get up the field, see the field. It makes the most fun and the best part of the game by any means. You get up the field, you see your eliminations, you kind of get most of the glory. You take away from the front guys because the front guys do all the work, but you still get up there, they still cause a lot of confusion. You get up front, you make the eliminations, you break the game, and it helps out the other team to move up the center in the process.
It's definitely most important for the mid guys to break the game. They find the seams, they pick their spots, they move in when they see the right time. You know, if you look seconds away, 2 minutes later, you ain't looking around, the mid player's gonna be up in your grill, putting it down on you. So, here's what some bomb diggity mid players can do for your team.
Watch.
Right?
When the
okay, LB, now you guys get in your bunkers, and the breakout's over, and you're just laying paint. What goes on after that?
Biggest thing, you know, is to not come off that trigger. You're going to want to keep putting paint out there and keep dominating to allow your front guys to go to work. It's real crucial, too, that you don't get hit off the initial break of the game, because if you do, it kind of leaves your front players hanging out there. Get in there, throw a lot of paint, control the game. You're responsible for, you know, 95% of the communication going on out there. So your front guys are going to want to talk to your mid guys are going to turn around and talk to you, and you're going to have to talk to everybody. Job number one, throw enough paint so you can allow your front guys to survive and go to work, mid guys to break the game open. And, you know, stay alive. You're like a quarterback on a football team. You know, you're responsible for making people do what they need to do. And you have quite a lot of responsibilities out there, but number one, stay alive. Two, shoot a lot of paint.
And this is where your naming of the bunkers and checking out the bunkers in your pregame walk really pays off also.
Yeah, and you know, when you're walking a field, you need to look for sweet spot lanes. And you know, where do you think the most crucial bunkers are going to be, and who you want to try to eliminate first. And then another big responsibility is, you know, you get out there and your front guys are going full tilt, running, diving into their bunkers, and they don't really know what's going on. You need to really go out there and scope it out and let your front guys know where guys are going to be and where they're at to allow them to, you know, go to work.
Today we pretty much went over the basics, went out over breakouts, what player does what when, how to play your bunker, and how to finish the game. But tonight, it's something that I can't even really teach. You pretty much got to learn on your own. It's called keeping it tight. It's all about the team.
Building that bond and creating that brotherhood that is what will make one team better than the other.
You go through life, I'm going to look 10 years, I'm going to look back. I don't even remember any great memories before I started paintball. All my best memories, all the best trips, are these guys. I remember going out with Steve and doing crazy stuff. You know, Sean, I don't have memories of anything else now. All I remember are these guys. You're with these guys all the time. They're your best friends.
It's a great time. I mean, you'll never ever meet the camaraderie of the paintball players that you get to play with.
They always say you don't have to like the guy you're playing next to, but I don't necessarily agree with that, because I mean, I love all these guys.
I mean, I can literally go around the room and tell you a quality and a trait that I love about every single one of these people.
Like, we always hang out. It's not like we're in separate little squads. It's a whole team. Like, we're all here right now together.
I don't live in the city with any of these guys. These guys all live all the way across the country, and they're my best friends.
This is my life. This is his life, his life, his life, all of our lives. This is what makes us happy. This is what drives us. It's competition. It's a brotherhood. It's a family. Most importantly, it's a team. And there's nothing better than that. I love
it. Amen. Silly stuff. Silly stuff. My accessory to the bride. Now we're going to go over two basic moves that are going to help you out as an individual player. Posting up and bunkering. Pew! Check it out. Posting up is pretty much getting methodical, playing tight, and just setting up on a player, waiting for him to pop out or to just give you anything. I mean, as soon as his bonnet comes out, bam, you blast him. Before you post up, it's a cat and mouse game. You gotta come out your bunker, mow the guy in. You might be teeter-tottering back and forth a couple times. Once the guy is in, you post up on the guy, and you just wait. When I post up, the thing I like to do is I'll throw a shot, skimming it by the edge of their bunker, probably one shot every 1 to 2 seconds. Just thinking maybe his timing will be off and he's gonna pop out and he's gonna catch that right in his melon. Wham! You gotta be quick on the trigger, you gotta have quick reflexes. I mean, you gotta have impeccable timing. As soon as you see some of his body coming out, you're squeezing the trigger, man, you're letting it fly, boom. And it's gonna catch him. Sometimes it's a pain in the butt because you sit in a spot for about 5 minutes and you're getting all cramped up, but you know if he comes out, you're getting the shot and you're getting the kill. And that's what posting up's all about right there. Bunkering is like a TKO. Boom, boom, bam. Bunkering is the best way to tell your opponent, dude, I just smacked you and I got the best of you and you can't do nothing about it. A, bunkerings are good for two reasons. It's a cleanup move where people want to show off and give it to the crowd and show the crowd some excitement. And B, bunkering is usually a necessity move that front players have to do to get rid of a bad guy in a good spot. The best way to bunker someone, coordinate it with the team like anything else you do on the field. You get up, you call a code, everybody gets their guns up, they mow the certain spots to keep their back players or mid players in. A front player or even a mid player runs up and just gets a little personal and tags that player out, boom, and he's out of there. The best way to bunker somebody, if you could do it, go around the bunker, stick them, and get back around the other side. That way, if that guy is hit, if he comes around and shoots you and you're clean, he might get a one for one, or the ref will wipe you off, pull him out, keep you in. I mean, you never want to run by a guy if all possible, unless you know you're going to get away with it clean and no one else is going to hit you. So far, everything we discussed revolves around the team concept, walking the fields, individual players for individual roles, and interacting with each other. What we're going to discuss right now is skills to keep you in the game, keep you alive so you can shoot people. Tell them what's up, LB.
First off, when you're out there shooting, you need to be aware of three things. One, your body, two, your hopper, and three, your equipment, and where that's positioned relative to your bunker.
If you've got feet or elbows or even hopper sticking out, someone's going to nail you, even if you feel like you're tucked into your bunker well. Also, know what you need to do to be able to shoot paint. You really only need two things, your marker and your goggles. You need to see and then shoot. You have to be able to see who and where you're shooting first. There's a specific way you can look out of your bunker in an air ball field and still keep most of your body hidden. Take your barrel and push the bunker to one side and peek around the space you've created. Don't lean your whole body around or someone's gonna nail you.
Besides working my butt off down at FLA Warp Sports, going to MPPL circuits and the Millennium circuits, I go to a lot of smaller events, see a lot of mistakes made by younger kids, young/novice teams. What we're going to go over in this section is what to do when things go terribly wrong on the field. Check it. I see a lot of young front and mid players. They'll shoot like way too much and they'll run out of paint and then they'll be stuck with no paint. I always practice with about 3 tubes less on practice days just so I know what I go through, and then in tournaments I'll throw in another two pods just so I don't run out. That comes as one of the basic techniques. You should know your paint consumption, and if you do run out of paint, don't ever voluntarily walk off the field. You don't want to do that. Remember, a body alive is a body alive. I mean, regardless, it is points. Your team should have a code on you running out of paint so that everybody on the field doesn't know except your team, and possibly one of your mid players or your back players could throw you a pod, and that way you're back in the game. If your marker goes down, A, you should know your marker good enough that you should be able to fix it right there on the spot. If you can't do it, become a target. I mean, pop up, you know, make the team concentrate on you. You need to help your team out any way possible. If you know that you ain't gonna be able to get your marker up and running at all, drop some pods. I mean, because you might get up, maybe run in the next bunker, cause some commotion, but you want to leave the pods for, like, say, another teammate that runs up and jumps in your bunker. If you're gonna go on a suicide run, coordinate it with your team. Don't just get up and go. They might be able to capitalize on you making your run. We pretty much covered the basics to get you guys started. We covered equipment, how to walk the fields, how to position your players front, mid, to back. We covered basic moves, bunkering, posting up, what to do in panic situations. What we're going to discuss now is what I consider the nitty-gritty to actually pull off and win games. Pulling the flag, guys, is the most important thing. Pulling and hanging the flag are the most important things. That's what you're going to get all your points from. When you grab the flag, if possible, try to come down the same wire that you came in. First of all, you know it's pretty much clear, and let your teammates take care of the other wire. No sense in going down a different wire when you know your wire's clean. Also, your front and back guys need to communicate with each other. Same with the mid guys. Front players need to move up where they can still get support from the back guys. There's no use in a front guy moving all the way forward and getting no support from the back guy. Last thing is to be careful about penalties, man. Playing on after you hit, it's just gonna give you minus points and it's gonna get other people pulled, and it's not gonna be worth anything, man. One for ones, it's not gonna help your team out at all.
All right, guys, that pretty much covers it. Remember, man, paintball is a hard game. You're not gonna turn into a pro team overnight. Just keep playing, play hard, stay true to yourself, and have fun, and everything else will fall into place. Stick around, we're going to have a Q&A session with Team Avalanche and a bunch of young California guys that won the Being the Avalanche video contest. Laters. All right, we're here with about a dozen kids that won the Being the Avalanche video contest. I'm going to give them a chance to ask some pros some questions, so let's get started. LB, Eric, here's some of my buddies.
Hey, what's up, guys? Come on in.
Come on in, man.
What's up, man?
How you doing?
Three hours.
There you go. Every single
day. Hey, you know what I said?
So as a young kid, what's a good way to get sponsored?
To be honest with you, man, sponsorship is the last thing you want to worry about. First thing, number one, go out there and have fun. That's why we all play. You know, we started playing because it was fun. It was an addiction. We loved it. And, you know, you go to a few tournaments and you win and you represent well, sponsorship's going to find you.
What do your friends and family think about paintball?
At first, you know, they weren't very educated about it, and everyone kind of looked at it as a war game. You know, it's far from a war game. Once they got a chance to check it out and come to events and see what it actually is and, you know, see how happy it made me, and they really thought it was pretty cool. You know, you got to have support from your family and your parents. If you don't, you're lost, especially being so young. You know, like, I started when I was 11. Without them, I wouldn't be here. Simple as that.
What's some tips you give an upcoming player?
You know, number one, play hard and play every single game like it's going to be the last game you're ever going to play in your life. And two, just go out there and have fun. You know, don't try and have all the coolest equipment and spend a grip of money on all the gear. You know, all you need is the basics. And if you got that, you have nothing else to worry about. Just have fun and try really, really hard.
What's the funnest part about being a pro?
I think some of the greatest things is just being able to travel, going around, being able to hang out with all your guys, like pretty much your brothers, traveling around, meeting other teams, meeting other pros. When you're out there, you get to go to the tournaments, go play and all day, and then go out at night and have fun getting out there and being able to meet a bunch of people. That's what about being a pro is. It's like going out there, having fun competition, but then just on top of it all, just having a good time.
We did a thing with Dave Mira and Ryan Nyquist. They did the Dave Mirra BMX show. You guys probably seen it. They did a stop at JT, and we had like a little little exhibition game kind of where they came out and tried out paintball. And those guys were pretty stoked on the whole deal. We did that, and this year I got to hang out with Les and Jake, the Metal Militia guys on the Warped Tour, Rancid, AFI. You get to do a lot of things that you don't expect to that's really not paintball related. It is in some way. But I mean, you just get to meet a group load of guys and just kicking around like that, get to see the world, get to travel everywhere, and it's all free. So that's the best part about it. You don't have to take anything out of your pocket.
All right. Hopefully we answered all the questions for you guys here, any guys at home, maybe taught you a trick or two about paintball. If you guys are ever at a tournament, you see Avalanche, swing on up, man. Say hi, man. We're all cool. I'm gonna leave you on one last action clip with one of my favorite bands, AFI. I hung out with these guys on the Warped Tour. Stellar dudes. The song's called Total Immortal. Stick around for some bonus tracks. For Avalanche, I'm Rocky Cagnoni. This was Avalanche 101. See ya. Peace.
Now hills keep farther away. Fish in the air. Fire.
Disappointed.